What's up, everybody? My name is Max Feinstein, and I'm an anesthesiology resident at the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. In this video, I'm going to be walking you through all of the medications that an anesthesiologist keeps in the medication cart in the operating room. Keep in mind that these are the non-controlled substances. Controlled substances like fentanyl and also medications like propofol are kept at the pharmacist, which are medications that I'll cover in a future video. I also just want to point out that anesthesiology is one of the few specialties where physicians are directly administering medications to their patients. It's one of the aspects of the field that appealed to me and I think makes it pretty unique. Many thanks to Dr. Erica Fagelman, one of the chief residents in the Mount Sinai Anesthesiology Program, who graciously took the time to narrate this video for us. Let's dive in.
So this is our standard medication drawer. This is something that is stocked daily and between each case, and these are medications that we don't need to pick up from the pharmacy. They are placed in here by our anesthesia techs, and so they are always available to us during every case. Some of them are more emergency drugs and others are just medications that we give routinely. So we have things like amiodarone in the case that a patient may have a heart arrhythmia that needs to be treated. We have a few different beta blockers, usually esmolol, our shorter acting beta blocker. We have metoprolol here, and then often on the side we'll also have a syringe of labetalol. We have 1% lidocaine, and we usually elsewhere have 2% lidocaine that can be used intravenously or to help anesthetize the skin before you place an IV. This is lubrication that can be used to assist you in preventing corneal abrasions once the patient's asleep. This can be can go in their eyes. And then we usually have a few medications that can treat hypertension, which we do see under anesthesia sometimes. So typically we'll use hydralazine or we'll use the labetalol that I showed you before. In terms of anti-nausea medications, we have a few different options that are typically stocked in the cart. Most commonly we use ondansetron or Zofran, and we use dexamethasone. Usually we give the dexamethasone at the beginning of the case, and a lot of people tend to give their Zofran at the end of the case. Other things, dexamethasone is a steroid, but we also have hydrocortisone. We don't typically use this for antiemetic purposes, but we tend to give this if somebody is on chronic steroids and needs stress dose steroids, or during transplants when we use this for immunosuppression. We have some of our more emergency drugs, I would say. So one of which is epinephrine. And in the cart here, this is 1 milligram. So obviously in the event of cardiac arrest, you might push this whole thing, but you can also make dilutions of this that will be in concentrations more appropriate for things like anaphylaxis or bronchospasm at smaller doses. Other more emergency drugs, we have norepinephrine, and this is a very concentrated vial, but we are also able to get this in a pre-mixed bag from the pharmacy in a more appropriate concentration to run as an infusion during particular cases. But this is here if you need it and you don't have that bag. And as I mentioned, we have atropine here. So this can be used for bradycardia, severe bradycardia. We have ephedrine. So this is a vasopressor that will increase the heart rate and the blood pressure. And then phenylephrine, which will also increase the blood pressure, but tends to actually decrease the heart rate. Other emergency drugs, we actually have albuterol. And this will come in a metered dose inhaler, but it also comes with an adapter so that we're able to give albuterol through the breathing tube once the patient's already asleep. And this is very important if we have anaphylaxis or bronchospasm for any reason under anesthesia. It can be life-saving. Other things in here, so we have our neuromuscular blockade or our paralytic agents, most commonly succinylcholine here and rocuronium here. Succinylcholine kicks in very quickly, so that's more of an emergency drug we always have drawn up, and that's something we would use in what we call a rapid sequence intubation when we want the patient to be intubated very quickly. There are some other miscellaneous drugs in here. Ketorolac or Toradol, that can be used for anti-inflammatory purposes. It's a great analgesic. We have Lasix in here if we think someone is fluid overloaded, or if we're doing a kidney transplant, that's part of the protocol during a kidney transplant. There is also diphenhydramine or Benadryl. So if someone is having some type of allergic reaction, obviously this would be something we can give quickly prior to resorting to epinephrine. And then we have medications that we actually use to reverse paralysis at the end of a surgery when you want the patient to start breathing again on their own. And that's typically a combination of two different medications, glycopyrrolate and neostigmine, which work together to give the patient strength again by increasing acetylcholine. And the glycopyrrolate is used so that they don't have some of the nasty side effects of that acetylcholine. So that will counteract things like secretions and and things like diarrhea, so that these work together to give the patient their strength without some of this unpleasant side effects.
That wraps up this tour of the anesthesiologist medication cart. I hope you found it interesting. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.